Australia, we might not have culture, but we do have viral sensations.
Over the last 12 weeks, we've travelled all around the country trying to find the people behind the biggest memes.
And in a world where everyone is desperate to go massive online, what happens to the people that do it by accident?
Here's what we've learned through our series, 15 Minutes.
It's really hard for me to pick a favourite, but I'd have to say Josh Saunders, because I just loved his energy. I loved going to his musical rehearsal.
Do the face.
You hated that so much when it was happening.
When you had to try it.
Yeah, they were like, do it.
And now we do it in slow motion.
Oh my god.
Serious.
That's like when you got me to floss with Nikki Webster.
Did you floss?
It's like 10 months too late and I'm getting Nikki Webster to floss.
Dude, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it was bad. My favourite actual genuine episode was doing the Yaya Next Door. The common thread with a lot of these people is that they went viral through like silly things. But just meeting people who have been through something so tragic but have come out the other side with a really positive message was so, so nice.
I was just glad to see the Yaya. That's who I was there for.
Right? Yaya was so, so funny. She was completely down with what was happening and she like fully understood the Instagram. I always have this idea that old people don't know what the internet is.
Get a Yaya that can do both. Go on Instagram, cook food.
And the cheesy balls were delicious.
What was it like interviewing Shannon Knoll?
There was a lot invested into this episode. Yeah. Everyone was fanging for Knollsy. He's very Australian country boy, I think, in his attitude and the way that he had us in his house. He wasn't trying to put anything on.
Yeah.
He was really accommodating. He was also really forthcoming about the fame. We didn't put this in the episode, but he spoke a lot about the incident at the Crazy Horse and just about how the media can spin things. He told us the backstory of what actually happened, and it's just crazy because we work in the media, but even I just read the headlines and I think, oh yeah, Shannon Knoll, what a dickhead, he got drunk and tried to fight someone at the Crazy Horse.
Yeah.
But that's not really what happened.
Like, I'm the first one to go like, yep, that was my fault. I'll take that, I'll wear it on the chin, you know? But I don't think that things were represented properly. You know what I mean? Like, for starters, Crazy Horse, they dropped all charges because there's no evidence of anything.
He got really, really worked up about that, and that to me shows that these people, like, obviously their headlines affect them, but I think it's really interesting that Shannon Knoll is now taking back the ownership by making those joke posts, because
yeah,
he knows that when he posts about fish tacos, they're all thinking he's posting about vaginas.
Going, yeah, but that's not the first fish taco, Knowlsy.
First episode, Mick Merry.
Not bad, good choice.
Oh, he's amazing. You're so good on camera. You're so funny. You have such a great personality. If he has a reality show next year, like, I wouldn't be surprised. But he's also really smart. Like, he was like, not bad, good size. Immediately trademarked it.
Trademarked it straight away. F***ing not bad.
Yep.
Good size, 2 seconds in. It's basically like Nike.
No other person we'd ever interviewed had thought to trademark their face or their catchphrase. And he straight off the block was like, I'm going to do this, I'm going to own it, I'm going to make money. I feel like he'd already learned from other people's mistakes.
Chespra, I feel like he's stuck in 2009.
I think it is, like shredding for stereo.
Yeah, he's still like shredding for stereo. Stereo's like long cancelled.
Yeah.
I also need to ask you, in the video, his housemate touches the small of your back and there was like one comment that got 100 likes about him doing this.
I didn't even notice it. Everyone else said, they were like, did that guy kind of touch your butt a bit? And I was like, I don't know. I was probably just trying to think of like the questions I was going to ask. But I think it was like a very, very microscopic hover hand that just,
ooh,
it looked like it was, but I think it was 1/10 of a millimeter away from my butt.
I loved the bangs episode.
Yeah.
Because he was quite shy and he was uncomfortable on camera. And that's what I thought was interesting to sort of watch, was over the progression of the episode, him sort of opening up. And he's another one, I still don't know if he is aware of whether or not people think it's a joke.
So I record the songs, I loved it, and I check it out on YouTube, and 4 months later, and then it just blew up.
Mia, the Por qué no los dos girl.
She was so wonderful.
She was cute.
She was, her art is like incredible. She's so well adjusted. I loved interviewing Mia because she was like on camera and off camera exactly the same person, and she was so bubbly and so genuine. There are a lot of people we tried to get that we couldn't, we could get a hold of, but they just didn't want to do it. Like, we tried to interview Corey Worthington and we went down there to Melbourne and we kind of agreed on this day, but then when we got there, he was unable to interview with us. Okay, so today I'm supposed to be talking to Corey Worthington, the party boy with the yellow glasses, and he has not shown up. He said he was going to meet us at 9 a.m. It is now 1 o'clock. and we've heard nothing. Oh my god, I thought that was cool. From the messages that I read, it sounded like he's going through some stuff, and that makes sense to me, that people have been trying to get in every loophole of your life, trying to like find out all the dirt about you. I think that it would make them uncomfortable to have to relive that.
Barking dog man. Lucy, our producer, tried phoning him, and he just said every time that the media comes back, like, his house will get egged. And they're the things that you don't read about, someone's house getting egged like 10 years after they've done in a current affair.
Yeah.
Like, it's such, there's such long-standing repercussions for these one moments. Also, there was Claire Werbeloff, so the Chick Chick Boom girl from The Cross.
And then they pulled out a gun and just went, chick, chick, boom.
I was so excited to interview her. She's
me too.
The one person I wanted to interview.
Right.
I think also being a female and going viral, like, there weren't that many females that we could interview. I don't know if that's because females don't do dumb shit.
Yeah. Some of them were dead. Can we mention that?
Yeah. Is this succulent Chinese man?
Yes.
This is Democracy Manifest.
Because we had two leads for him. I think we had one that was like a professional chess player, and then we had one that was dead, and I think it turned out he was both.
It's a bad lemon chicken.
Yeah.
Get your hand off my penis!
I would hate to go viral. Like, after watching this, I'm just like, because that would be the only thing that you would ever be known for.
Going viral is a little bit like having a really traumatic experience.
Yeah.
In that you can become really hateful from it, or you can be really positive. And we've seen that with the Yaya boys. We've seen it with Bangs. They just have this positive outlook on life, and it's infectious. I'm just exhausted even thinking about these episodes and like the stuff that these people go through when they are in the peak of their virality.
Chess Bros said something that really resonated with me in regards to this series, which was, if you're not ready for it, fame can really f you up. And I think that's true. Like, I think it's all about the space that you're in when you achieve that viral fame.
Totally. And I think it's important having the right people around you, because you're going to have people trying to grab at that fame as well. If you don't have like good friends and family, I think that's when it can really f*** up.